The first question asked for sketches on B cell development and activation to produce antibodies. First, for A, development of B cells from stem cells, each with their own specific B cell receptor. Then, binding of the B cell receptor to an antigen, and binding of a helper T cell to the same antigen, and then sending a chemical message to the cell. Replication of that activated now B cell through multiple rounds of division, and then production of free antibodies. Those antibodies binding to targets, and then the antibody-bound targets being recognized by the bound antibody by a macrophage and ingested and destroyed. This first one shows the original stem cell. This would be in an embryo, with the multiple different possibilities, A1, A2, A3, B1, and so on, B2. So there'd be multiple versions of the A segment, A1, A2, A3 here, 1, 2, 3, multiple versions of the B segment, version 1, version 2, and version 3, and also of the C. So I'm oversimplifying a bit, but the general idea is this much longer gene in the original stem cell would have some parts cut out, and so it would be left with 1A subunit, 1B, and 1C. Those variable subunits are at these binding pockets. And each of these antibodies has two binding pockets in a Y shape, and they would be identical. But the binding pocket of this one would be different from this one, which would be different from this one in many millions of different possibilities. So when an invader comes in, there's some foreign antigen here, and it could be a free antigen, it could be a bound antigen from a cell that has maybe a virus or something inside, and it's taking fragments of that virus and putting them in the MHC class 1. So that cell is constantly moving MHC class 1 out to the surface with these whatever molecules are inside, including self molecules and foreign molecules. Now, the self molecules are ignored by the immune system because any receptor that could bind a self molecule, any cell that had it was killed during development. Any helper T cell that had a receptor that could bind a self molecule was killed during development. So when this foreign antigen is either free or bound, that can activate a B cell. The B cell will needs two activations. It needs this antigen binding here, and it also needs a helper T cell that can bind to the same antigen. In other words, it needs two signals, and with that second signal, the helper T cell, when it's activated, releases its cytokines to our nearby now being activated B cell. That second signal plus this signal, both required, they activate this now into an active B cell. Again, two signals. It needs to bind free antigen, and it also needs a helper T cell that has a receptor that can bind to that same target, that same antigen. This helps to reduce false attacks and helps to reduce the risk of autoimmune disease. It means that this one cell that happens to have an activated receptor here can't just divide like crazy without a second signal that says, yes, there really was a foreign molecule here. I detected it too. And so with these two, now we activate it and it reduces the chances of autoimmune disease. So now our activated B cell goes through multiple rounds of division, so we get many copies, and now it's all A1, B3, C1, same as here, and same as up here. So now we have many mature B cells that are producing antibodies. Those antibodies then can bind to whatever these foreign molecules are, so whenever they're outside of a cell, either a bacterium or a virus. Here it is binding, and they can clump them because of the Y can bind to two different bacteria and another antibody. might bind here and here, clumping all of these together. That alone can make it difficult for viruses and for bacteria, because clumped together, they can't do their normal things. They and too tightly packed and they starve, they're blocked from nutrients. However, a bound antibody changes its shape, and that change in shape is recognized by a protein in macrophages. So a macrophage will bind to anything that is attached to an antibody, ingest it, fuse that vesicle with a lysosome, and digest, so release acids and enzymes in to digest whatever's in there and destroy it. Second question asked for a sketch or sketches showing MHC class 1 proteins that are different for every individual. And while I oversimplified a bit in the notes, MHC class 1 involves many genes, so there's multiple genes that code for this the protein, and my estimate was 20 genes, each with perhaps 10 alleles, could be more than that. Anyway, they MHC1s, they can all bind peptides, but they have different sequences in some part of it. So this is one way of showing it. It's not so much that this region is different, it's some other region here that is different. Here's another way, an MHC class 1. Of course, all MHC class 1s are putting self molecules in there, and bacterial or viral, whatever's inside the cell, fragments of peptides and proteins and stuff get stuck in there. But this MHC1 is different from this MHC1. And here's another way of showing the same thing. It's again, not so much these regions that are different, they're different in some other location that the immune system can detect and know whether it's the correct one. So every individual has its own MHC class 1, and if it's the wrong one, that means it's not a self cell and it'll be attacked. So how do non-self or foreign MHC class 1 proteins cause killer T cells, cells to attack and destroy foreign cells? So if it's a self MHC class 1, then the self T cell won't attack it, won't recognize it as foreign. But if it's a foreign MHC, so here's a different shape, if it's a foreign MHC, that'll activate a killer T cell, and I haven't talked about the mechanism. That activation then causes that killer T to do things like release perforins that could put pores in the cell and cause it to leak to death, also releases other molecules like reactive oxygen species and so on, and that destroys that non-self cell. Of course, that's dangerous for nearby cells because these perforins don't necessarily all go to that target. And so an activated immune system does get rid of foreign attackers, but it also causes some damage to local self cells. The immune system is a double-edged sword. How would a drug that prevented gene rearrangement in cells of the immune system affect it? At two different times, what if the drug was given during embryonic and fetal development? Or if the drug was given to a young adult animal. Now, during embryonic and fetal development, that is the time when all of these rearrangements are happening of these receptors, these surface receptors on A and B cells. And so instead of getting a huge range of different receptors, we've prevented all those rearrangements. And so we get very limited rearrangements. We might have all of them, in this case, be A1, B1, A1, B1, B1. And so we don't have the same variation. While it'll bind this antigen, all these other shapes of antigens won't be bound. And so this immune system is not going to respond to a lot of foreign invaders. This answer was similar up here. If it's given during fetal development, there's going to be a poor immune system because the child will not build up any immunity to viruses and bacteria without gene rearrangements. They can't build up immunity without getting variable regions in these binding sites. What if it's given to a young adult? Well, the young adult has already had these gene rearrangements. So here we are with A1, 2, C2, and E3 versus C2, D6, and E7, and so on. And so this one has a variety of binding regions. And so it's going to have little or no effect. A young adult has already developed the T and B cells, not just the memory cells, but has the naive T and B cells all ready to go with all the different binding sites. And so it's not going to have much of an effect on the adult. Now, there is some limited rearrangement, gene rearrangement, that happens. Once a B cell is activated, it can do a little bit, there's a little bit of rearrangement that goes on in this region that just slightly changes it, and that gives a chance for the B cell to get some very small differences that might improve the ability to bind and attack that particular antigen. So that would be lost, but nothing else would. And that's a much smaller effect than what happens during embryonic development. Finally, if a virus attacks and kills many helper T cells, how would that affect the response to a viral infection? And helper T cells are needed to activate the killer T cells that are naive. Those T cells could still bind the antigen, but without helper T cells, if it's lost a lot of helper T cells, needs the helper T cells to activate it. And so what we've lost is some of the ability to activate killer T cells. What about it's an infection in which all the bacteria are extracellular, the bacteria never enter cells? Well, in this case, killer T cells are not important because killer T cells attack and kill cells. So what's going to matter here is that we, without helper T cells, we need another class of helper T cells to activate B cells. So the B cells could still encounter the foreign antigen. They could still have it in them and present at the surface, but they would not be able to secrete antibodies because they need the cytokine. In this case, it's interleukin-4. They need the cytokine from the helper T cell. Here it is in a sketch. So we would still get an antigen-presenting cell or a free antigen binding. It could still be presented on the surface of a B cell or a T cell, but we're not going to have the helper T cells to bind that same antigen and to release cytokines. So we have fewer activated killer T cells. This person wrote no B or T cell activation, which would be correct, but the key thing for a viral infection is we would not have activated killer T cells. And of course, antibodies, B cells can be activated as well to produce antibodies to the viruses. So both of those would matter. In the case of our bacterium that is never inside cells, the killer T cells are not so important. So we wouldn't have them, but we wouldn't expect them anyway. In this point case, fewer activated B cells is the problem and fewer antibodies.